Hi, everyone. Aaron here for zollotech, and I've been using the M1 MacBook Pro over the past month, and I've been using it most of the time as my full-time editing computer. So every video you've seen, with the exception of a couple, have been edited completely on this M1 MacBook Pro, as well as all of the thumbnails for the video, recording all of the audio and everything else. So I've been using it a lot, and I've been using it connected to a 6K Pro Display XDR when I'm not mobile. So if I'm in an office where I have my display and I'm using it while it's connected to that display, and it works just fine with that. So I wanted to talk about what it's like to use. Like I said, I've been using it full time connected to an external display, sometimes editing without the display. And I'll talk about what it's like, not just editing, but also for games and more. Now, the first thing is its overall design, of course, is very familiar. You have a headphone port on the right hand side, but we're lacking two additional ports. Apparently this will be in later models, but that's probably my biggest complaint about this MacBook at this point, is I could use some more ports. We only have two on the left hand side. So you have two, but you can expand them with a dock, like you saw where I'm connecting it to the 6K monitor. I'm using an OWC Thunderbolt 3 dock, and that works great for things like memory card readers, maybe Ethernet and additional things like that. Of course, you have this nice 13-inch form factor, and thankfully Apple kept the scissor keyboard that they brought back that everyone likes. So it's got good key travel, good feedback. It's fairly quiet. And when you're using it like this, it's just much better to use, at least for me anyway, compared to the previous sort of butterfly keyboard. You have that nice large trackpad and a pretty nice display as well. It might be a little bit small for me, but for most people that like this size laptop, it's going to be great. It's nice and vibrant. It goes up nice and bright, and it seems to work well. There are brighter displays out there, and the bezels may be a little bit thick for some people, but for me, it doesn't really bother me. And like I said, I'm usually using an external display anyway. Now, the overall price of this, I think, is a good value for what you get compared to other Macs. And I'll talk about that in a moment as far as speed. So this particular Mac is the top of the line 16 gigabyte of RAM with 2 terabytes of storage. So it's the most expensive one you can get, about $2,300 or so, depending on how you spec it out. Now, you don't necessarily need that extra 2 terabytes of storage unless you're editing video, then I would suggest get as much as you can get. But for me, it's sort of necessary with editing video. You could use an external drive, maybe like a T7 drive from Samsung, which I have here. I usually offload footage to this. So these are probably a cheaper option, and you can edit right through the Thunderbolt port with these. So if you wanted to do that, you could get the smaller storage option. Now, I edit all my video on this, and it's just super fast. In fact, just using it regularly feels much faster than an Intel Mac for some reason. So if you're just opening different applications, going through, the responsiveness overall is just crazy fast all the time. So if you're using this for a disk speed test, for example, we'll just hit start. You're going to get 2,000 to 3,000 megabits, or megabytes per second rather, just using it normally. So it's super fast there. Now, I did run some Geekbench scores just to show you in this, but this is just sort of a general idea of what it can do. But for OpenCL, it scored 19,195. If we go to the single core versus multi-core, we had 1,738 and 7,645 for multi-core. So it's pretty good. So compared to an iMac of this year, it's quite a bit faster as far as that goes. And it doesn't make a lot of sense how fast this is. So like I said, I've been using it for editing, and when you go into something like Final Cut Pro, for example, here's my AirPods Max video that I did an unboxing of. Now, the amazing thing is it plays this back in the best quality without any hiccups whatsoever. So maybe I hit space to play, hit L, that will sort of scrub through this faster, and it will jump, and you'll see it's nice and smooth. This is footage from an FX9, a Sony FX9 here, and also a Sony A7S III is the top-down camera. And H.265 is what it's playing back here, and then H.264 is what it's playing back on the FX9. So it's combining this footage, and it's just super smooth all the time. My Mac Pro cannot do that. It will not play this back smoothly. And if we go to show in viewer, for example, and show the angles at the same time and play it back, you'll see it's still playing it back smoothly. Now it's starting to hiccup a little bit here, but my Mac Pro does the exact same thing, and I cannot play this back smoothly using a Mac Pro. If I play it back in real time, it's fine. If I try to go faster, it will sort of start to hiccup. It's the only time I could get it to do that. And when I was exporting a video, I exported a video, the exact same video, this video, and I had it rendered out to about 2 minutes and 19 seconds on both the Mac Pro and this MacBook Pro. The Mac Pro finished it in 7 minutes and 46 seconds when I exported the video. The M1 MacBook Pro finished it in 45 seconds longer, 8 minutes and 31 seconds. So this plays it back smoother and exports a little bit slower, but this costs $2,300. The Mac Pro is over $15,000. So this is basically like a portable Mac Pro that's of a much higher value when you compare it to things like that. Now, not everyone's going to be editing video, of course, but things that are built in, such as documents or pages or Word, any of that's going to be super fast. No issues there. But when you're playing games, you might be surprised that it actually runs pretty smoothly. So maybe I go into something like Steam, for example, and I want to play Planet Coaster, which is fairly intensive. We'll go ahead and go down here, hit play. We'll wait for it to launch. And the impressive thing is this is using Rosetta 2 to actually play this. So in order to play this, it actually has to convert from i86 type footage to this M1 Mac footage seamlessly. And it does that when it installs, it sort of puts all the libraries necessary to convert it. And it's surprising that this will play it without a problem. So we'll wait for it to load and I'll show you what I mean. Now this is running at 60 Hertz. So the game's running at 60 Hertz. That's what the display is capable of. Anyway, I've got full resolution 2352 by 1470, and I have most settings set to high. So I don't have everything on, but most settings are set to high, and I just kind of bumped this up to custom. But if I hit okay, you'll see how smooth this is. And this is not really something I would necessarily recommend to buy to play a game, but you'll see there was a slight hiccup when I began to move. Now it's nice and smooth. If I want to zoom in or zoom out, I can do that, move around, and it's not perfect, but you can see here's a little bit of a line in the game. So it's not perfect, but it is nice and smooth for the most part and very playable. And this is being translated through Rosetta 2 so that you can actually play it. That's the impressive thing about it. And this is probably the only time I've actually seen the Mac get warm. So yes, you're not going to have blazing fast frame rates. You've got 60 Hertz displays anyway, but it's definitely playable for most games if they're supported on Mac and you can just translate those through Rosetta, which is very impressive. So if I close out of this, for example, we'll just hit okay. It does take a while to load the game. This is one of the few things that will actually make the MacBook warm in my use of it. So it starts to get a little bit warm. Sometimes the fan will kick in and sometimes the bottom will get warm. Right now, it's just barely warm on the bottom. So the thermals are managed very well in this laptop. It's a little warm right here. And the only time I've got it warm when it was editing is when it was connected to that external display. So the 6K resolution was really pushing the graphics chip on here. And that's when it started to get warm. And as you can see, when it's connected in closed clamshell mode, where the display is closed, but it's using an external display, it's getting quite warm. You can see that with a FLIR thermal camera that the bottom gets warm and also the top, and you can actually see where the exhaust vent is pushing out air. So it definitely will get warm, but it's nothing like Macs of the past. It doesn't have ever thermal throttle on me, and it just sort of pushes through this footage no problem. Now, using this for anything other than Final Cut or a game, for example, it's going to sort of blaze through any of that footage. So for example, you're using it for maybe, I guess, Final Cut Pro will open Safari. If we go to apple.com, you can have all of these things open, news, the App Store, settings. You'll see how fast everything just sort of pops open. So if we go over to, we'll open this app again. Everything's just instant on here, and that's where it's really amazing. It just feels so fast all the time, and that's what makes me go back from my Mac Pro to this. It just seems like it's super fast all the time. So that's great about it. It's got great microphones. And let me have you hear the speakers and then we'll take a look at the microphone. But if I go to a comparison I did where I edited it on here, I'll jump to the section with music. We'll go over here and I'll play back some of the music for you. So we'll turn up the speakers here and I'll move my microphone. So hopefully that gives you an idea of what it's like to use the MacBook with its speakers. But let's take a look at the microphone, because the microphone's quite good on here. It has studio mics as well. Now let me switch over to the microphone on the MacBook Pro, and now I'm recording with the MacBook Pro. Now the audio from it is quite impressive when you're just using it to record audio. Maybe you need to voice something over. It will work great for that. But this camera is probably the lowest possible quality camera you could put in this laptop. I think for what it is, it should be a better camera. And I think we'll see that in the future, but they do use the neural engine on the new chipset in here to help out with that. So it's better than before, but it still needs an upgrade as well. So let's go ahead and close out of that. So we'll save that. And what I'll do is I'll just export this. We'll export it as 720p so you could see it earlier at this point. So 720p webcam. You'll see it's saving. This will take a moment, so I'll just minimize it here. It takes just a second to save that. We're good to go. I can close QuickTime Player. So we'll delete this now, and we're good to go. It's super fast to use for everything. And of course, the last thing is battery life. Battery life is amazing on this MacBook Pro. So battery right now is at 74%. I've edited a full 15 to 20 minute comparison using this from 100% and wasn't even down to 50% after I exported the video. That's something I can't do on a 16 inch MacBook Pro, for example. It just won't handle that. Maybe 2 or 3 hours max on that 16 inch MacBook Pro. Apple says you'll get 20 hours of video playback. This easily lasts me 2 days. I don't know about 20 hours for what I'm doing, but at least 6. So you can see this is usage and I plug it in a lot, but screen on usage, some days I use it a couple hours and I don't plug it in often unless it's plugged into that external display. It's just incredible how long this battery lasts. So yes, you're going to get through a couple days. If you go to work and you're working an 8-hour day, even a 10-hour day, you're going to get at least a day and a half of use out of it, or 2 days, depending on how often you're using it. If you leave it on and you're not at full brightness all day long, it will work just fine. So it's amazing how long the battery lasts. It's not a bigger battery. It's just got the M1 chipset, which is more similar to what we have in the iPhone. So it just lasts a lot longer. So the only thing I don't like about this is I would like a bigger display. I don't really care about the touch bar and I would like some extra ports. Otherwise, it's the perfect travel laptop and I'll use it to travel. Even if they come out with a bigger one, I'll probably use this one to travel and edit videos with when we are back to actually traveling and going to different events. So when that time comes, I'll probably use this unless Apple has something that's much better at that point. But right now, this is, in my opinion, a portable Mac Pro. So this does all the tasks I need of the Mac Pro. It's quiet. It's only ever spun up the fans twice, once playing that game, once exporting video, and only when it's connected to that external display does it spin up the fan. Otherwise, it doesn't when you're exporting video. So it's incredibly quiet. It works great. It has amazing battery life, and I highly recommend it. But let me know what you think of it in the comments below. If there's anything else you'd like to know about the M1 MacBook Pro, let me know in the comments, and I'll try and answer those at least for the first hour after the video. Now, if you'd like to get your hands on the wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.